What does Mr. Pound do?
He's a lawyer, and his law clerks. A fairly recent appointment, but enjoying it. A lot of varied work, so...
A lawyer.
Isn't it obvious? Lady Croft, my pleasure. Manfred Powell, QC.
Good morning.
I believe you are quite an authority on things ancient and mythological.
Oh, I travel.
No, no, Mr. Wilson said you were quite the archaeologist. Please.
He's very sweet.
He knew your father, I believe.
Yes, they were great friends.
I had the honor of meeting him myself once, in Venice. I'm so sorry to hear about his death.
This is the clock I spoke of.
Very interesting. It's a shame you only brought photographs. Nevertheless, it is fascinating. You said it started ticking the night of the alignment.
Yes. You said you were a lawyer?
Yes.
And the study of clocks is a hobby?
This is an obsession. Really my speciality. My practice centers around antiquities. But the origin of this clock completely eludes me. I think I've never seen anything quite so beautiful that I know so little about. This is a pleasurable torment.
My ignorance amuses me.
In a world overflowing with movies, we need a hero. Someone to separate the bad from the good.
Hi everyone, I'm Em and welcome to Verbal Diorama episode 249, Lara Croft Tomb Raider and Lara Croft Tomb Raider, The Cradle of Life. This is the podcast that's all about the history and legacy of movies you know and movies you don't. And as always, hi, hello, welcome to Verbal Diorama. Whether you are a regular listener, whether you are a brand new listener of this podcast, thank you for being here. Thank you for choosing to listen to this podcast. And as always, I'm so happy to have you here. Just generally, but also for the history and legacy of Lara Croft Tomb Raider and Lara Croft Tomb Raider, The Cradle of Life. They are both exceptionally long titles. You've got to ask the question, why are they so long? But never mind. As always, thank you so much to everyone who does continue to listen and support this podcast and has done for the last 5 years, because I've been doing this for 5 years now. And not only that, we are coming up to the 250th episode of this podcast, which is crazy. So most recent episodes I've done, it's been Women's History Month. So I've wanted to focus on women in film, and I've done that by looking at episodes on the history and legacy of Wonder Woman, A Quiet Place, and Fighting With My Family. Wonder Woman, I guess pretty obvious, you know, she is probably the most well-known female superhero of all time. But then A Quiet Place was kind of more for the depiction of motherhood in a very extreme and stressful situation, and Fighting With My Family about women in sport, and specifically working class women from Norwich who very rarely get movies made of their life in Hollywood. However, Fighting With My Family was the exception, and it's a truly terrific little movie. And I wanted to finish this month looking at women in the male gaze, but also examples of female empowerment. And in a change to the way that I usually do things, before we jump into the trailer for 2001's Lara Croft Tomb Raider, let's look at the story behind the original game and just how the character of Lara Croft came to be.
What's a man got to do to get that kind of attention from you?
It's hard to say exactly, but you seem to be doing fine.
Well, great. Though truth is, it ain't me that wants you.
Oh?
No, Miss Jacqueline Natla does, from Natla Technologies. You know, creator of all things bright and beautiful.
Seal it, Larson.
Ma'am.
Feast your eyes on this, Lara. How does that make your wallet rumble?
I'm sorry. I only play for sport.
Then you'll like a big park. Peru. Vast mountain ranges to cover. Sheer walls of ice. Rocky crags. Savage winds. And there's this little trinket. An age-old artifact of mystical powers buried in the unfound tomb of Qualapec. That's my interest. You could leave tomorrow. Are you busy tomorrow?
1996 was a pretty incredible year for video games. The Nintendo 64 debuted, the first true 64-bit console, and with it, one of the console's defining games, Super Mario 64. It's widely considered one of the best games for the console and one of the best Mario games ever made, having a 3D Mario, an expansive world where you could explore anywhere, and a floating camera was all pretty groundbreaking. The idea of true 3D engines and introducing a Z-axis to the field of play was revolutionary. Super Mario 64 changed platformers, and Quake, the successor to Doom, offered 3D rendering on Windows, MS-DOS, and Linux, and had early support for 3D acceleration through OpenGL, and also introduced online multiplayer in 1996. Trust me, when I was reading back through all of this, all of what happened in video gaming in 1996, when I was video gaming myself, I was truly blown away by how much actually happened in the mid-90s for video games. Because meanwhile, on the PlayStation, Tekken 2 would become a game changer for fighting games. Resident Evil would also become the survival horror game to inspire all survival horror games, as well as funding Paul W.S. Anderson's lifestyle for the best part of 14 years. These are all games that shaped my childhood and my obsession with video games. I still own a first-generation PlayStation. It's honestly one of my favourite things that I have in my house, and also a copy of Tekken 2. Unsurprisingly, Resident Evil is not my favourite because it's too scary. However, I adored Super Mario 64, and I've played that recently on the Switch, and it is still as delightful as it ever was. But arguably, 1996 was a big year for many video game developers, and then more so than Core Design. Core, based not far from Verbal Diorama HQ up in Derby, was founded in 1988 by nine friends: Chris Shrigley, Andy Green, Rob Toon, Terry Lloyd, Simon Phipps, Jay Pridmore, Jeremy Heath-Smith, Kevin Norburn, and Greg Holmes. They'd all previously worked at Gremlin Graphics. It was originally called Megabyte until the name was changed to Core. The team worked on games for the Commodore 64, Atari ST, and Amiga, and they fostered a very laid-back atmosphere. They were also the first British studio to receive a license from Sega to develop games for the Genesis. Finances were pretty tight before being acquired by Centergold in 1994. Centergold was then acquired by Eidos Interactive in 1996 for $17.6 million. There's that year again, 1996. Before their acquisitions, back in 1993, they'd started working on a game called Tomb Raider. It was just a prototype, but it formed the basis of why Eidos wanted to acquire them. In 1993, work started on this action-adventure platform game with an Indiana Jones-style character, a man, as the hero, because the vast majority of video games had male heroes, and the female characters would always need saving. As development continued, the team began favouring stealth and puzzle elements over action, and questions about the lead character, Lucasfilm copyright notwithstanding, a female character seemed increasingly a better choice. To create something different to everyone else, break away from stereotypes, and have a character who could be both brains and brawn. Female video game characters existed, but their femininity was never the main focus. Ms. Pac-Man was just a yellow circle with a pink bow and lipstick. And Samus Aran from Metroid was a one piece made of pixelated curves. Samus Aran's spacesuit concealed her gender unless the game was completed in under a set amount of time. Core Design co-founder Jeremy Heath-Smith wasn't fond of the idea of switching the character's gender because there were so few games that featured female protagonists. But he came round to the idea when it was noted that there were so few games with a female protagonist and this would potentially be their USP. So artist Toby Gard created concept art featuring a new character, a woman, but not Lara Croft. Her name was Laura Cruz. Beginning as a gritty military type before evolving into a more sophisticated combination, tall and slender, but witty, articulate and fearless, inspired by pop singer Nina Cherry and Tank Girl. As video game characters went, she'd take more from Samus Aran than from Princess Peach or Zelda. Similar to Indiana Jones, without the name Indiana Jones. But Laura Cruz wouldn't stay Laura Cruz for long. The worry was that international markets, namely the US, would struggle to pronounce Laura, or the more Spanish pronunciation, Laura. Laura became Lara, Cruz became Croft, and the feminine edges morphed into a tough British aristocrat who preferred excavations and archaeology to dinners with lords and ladies. She wore clothing that could easily be coded, brown shorts, a blue vest top, backpack, and two pistols with unlimited ammo. It is ironic, though, because most podcasts with American hosts that I've listened to talk about Lara Croft, or indeed Tomb Raider, actually do call her Laura Croft. So clearly they could have kept Laura, but it is Lara, not Laura. They are totally different names. But Lara wasn't just a character in a video game. Gard and his core colleagues wanted to give her recognisable movements and a core, excuse the pun, personality. He believed that if Lara moved more realistically, players would empathise with her more easily. Not only that, but he also wanted to make a difference in comparison to the industry standard at the time. Her moveset is limited, but she could pull herself up ledges, handstand, swan dive, sprint and crouch, as well as run and swim. Because of engine constraints, her trademark braid wasn't in the original game. Even though early prototypes showed that the developers were trying to model the braid, they ultimately refused to compromise on performance and level of detail. The braid would appear in sequels and also in the remastered Tomb Raider 1-3 that came out in February 2024, just last month as of this recording. Similar to how Lara's boots had red laces in the first game but tan in later installments, her shirt didn't have the low cut that would be used in subsequent games. The game engine's limitations in the first installment made Lara's breasts notoriously triangular. Subsequent games had more sophisticated models. This was because Tomb Raider, the original game, was based on cubes. Everything in the game is either a cube, multiple cubes, or angled cubes. Even Lara's movements were based on the number of cubes that she could move. A standing jump would be one cube's distance. A running jump would be two cubes' distance. Because, to the amazement of teen boys everywhere, this character had breasts. Blocky breasts, but breasts all the same. And although it would become obvious that Core wanted to capitalise on Lara's eventual sex appeal, they gave Toby Gard creative control over the game, and he was steadfast on his pure intentions for Lara, despite accidentally making her breasts bigger. When they asked him to include a nude code, he refused to do it. Lara was his idea of, quote, a female character who was a heroine, you know, cool, collected, in control, that sort of thing. So it was never the intention to create some kind of page three girl to star in Tomb Raider, unquote. Eidos' marketing department, though, took advantage of the character's perceived strengths and positioned her as a sex symbol. Posters and advertisements featured her in provocative poses and wearing clothing that left little to the imagination. Gard pitched ideas to play up Lara's sophistication, strength and poise, but Eidos marketers shooed him away. His job was to make games, their job was to sell those games as they saw fit. A fan-made patch for Tomb Raider games on PC that stripped Lara of her clothing was unsanctioned and aggressively combated by Core, but spread like wildfire across the internet, which didn't help Gard's case. But the appeal of Lara meant this wasn't just Tomb Raider, this was Tomb Raider featuring Lara Croft. It's even on the cover. And before the internet, the only way to get Tomb Raider seen were game expos and demo discs. By late spring of 1996, Tomb Raider wasn't actually getting all that much attention. While showing off some of their upcoming graphics cards in Core's office that June, representatives from the manufacturer 3DFX had someone in the program quickly add support for 3D graphics acceleration to the PC version of the game. Thanks to the 3DFX hardware, the already beautiful game looked stunning. As soon as Eidos showed the game's demo at E3, the gaming press started to show up. Reviewers praised Tomb Raider's clever level design and puzzle design, and the official PlayStation magazine featured a playable demo and Lara on the front cover. With that, plus the glowing reviews, it wasn't just teenage boys clamouring to get a copy of Tomb Raider. The game wowed upon release, being one of the first games to utilise a 3D environment in full extent and provide a cinematic feel due to the third-person perspective. Some of their locations are still impressive, if not by the graphics compared to modern games, then by their ingenious design with cleverly designed levels and technical development that belied the capabilities of the consoles at the time. It was even suggested that because the game had to work with the Sega Saturn, that the design was limited and that Sony's PlayStation was even more powerful and capable, as subsequent sequels to Tomb Raider proved. Despite Tomb Raider's outstanding gameplay and graphics, Lara took centre stage. She was not just a pretty face. She was tough and smart, the epitome of 90s feminism, as embodied by 90s girl power icons like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Xena Warrior Princess, and of course, the Spice Girls. Lara broke out of the video game industry and appeared on the covers of mainstream magazines like Newsweek, Time, and Rolling Stone as Tomb Raider's appeal increased. She also appeared in ads for LucasAid. She was promoted using real models who cosplayed as her officially, including the likes of Rona Mitra and Neil McAndrew, who'd become famous based on purely being Lara Croft, with McAndrew specifically capitalising on it for features in lads mags like FHM, which also focused on Lara's sexuality despite her being made of pixels. Lara Croft changed the face of video gaming in a time when masculinity and masculine endeavours dominated the genre. The trend shifted from first-person shooters and family-friendly platformers to characters with mature narratives and relatable personalities. And this was something that was only enhanced throughout her ongoing games, as well as highlighting her sexuality. It also changed the narrative at core. Eidos realised they had a cash cow on their hands and demanded a sequel for the following year, with a larger environment, expanded movements, and the ability to use vehicles. The quick turnaround led to serious burnout within the team, which led to Eidos assigning another team to the following year's Tomb Raider 3, and even before that game's release in 1998, the team had already moved on to Tomb Raider 4, The Last Revelation, which came out in 1999. The ambiguous ending of The Last Revelation led to many speculating that Lara Croft was now dead. She wasn't, of course, but not for the want of cause developers trying to kill her. The development team had been overworked for years, and despite receiving hefty bonus payments based on the lucrative sales, the game's popularity was in decline. And by the release of Tomb Raider The Angel of Darkness in 2003, the sixth Tomb Raider game and the first for the PS2, which had taken 2 years to finish, was critically mauled. Tomb Raider, once a fresh new game inspiring others, was now reduced to copying ideas from games like Metal Gear Solid and Shenmue. Even though Angel of Darkness sold 2.5 million copies, Core was tired of Tomb Raider and Eidos was similarly tired of Core. Eidos executives told Core that one of its American studios, Crystal Dynamics, would be taking over development of Tomb Raider going forward in an attempt to protect the Tomb Raider brand. Which is again ironic to have the Core Tomb raided and its prized jewel, Lara Croft, stolen away to another team. Crystal Dynamics were most famous for Gex the Gecko and Legacy of Kain Soul Reaver. And Soul Reaver, which is a terrific game and another that I still own, would become the basis of inspiration for Tomb Raider going forward. And Tomb Raider Legend, released on the game's 10th anniversary, received almost universal acclaim. Crystal Dynamics followed up with Tomb Raider Anniversary, a total remake of the original game in 2007, and Tomb Raider Underworld in 2008, and with that, a renewed interest to highlight Lara's empowerment and abilities over her curves and boob size. But during the development of Tomb Raider The Last Revelation and Tomb Raider Chronicles, Eidos were also working with Paramount on Lara Croft Tomb Raider, Lara's first foray into cinema. So, here's the trailer for Lara Croft Tomb Raider.
Tomb Raider. Play.
Born into wealth.
The future is yours now, Lara. The all-seeing eye.
Groomed by the elite.
Have you ever heard of the Clock of Ages?
It gives its possessor power of the people of the light.
And trained for combat.
We can be partners.
You might try to kill me.
I'm not gonna kill you.
I said you'd try.
Jolie. Is Lara Croft. Lara Croft.
Time to save the universe?
Absolutely.
Tomb Raider.
Orphaned heiress and intrepid archaeologist Lara Croft embarks on a dangerous quest to retrieve the two halves of an ancient artifact which controls time before it falls into the wrong hands. As an extremely rare planetary alignment is about to occur for the first time in 5,000 years, the fearless Tomb Raider will have to team up with rival adventurers and the Illuminati to collect the pieces while time is running out. Let's run through the cast. We have Angelina Jolie as Lara Croft, Ian Glenn as Manfred Powell, John Voight as Lord Richard Croft, Daniel Craig as Alex West, Noah Taylor as Bryce, Chris Barry as Hillary, Julian Reintert as Mr. Pims, and Leslie Phillips as Wilson. Lara Croft Tomb Raider has a screenplay by Patrick Massett and John Zinman, adaptation by Simon West, story by Sarah B. Cooper, Mike Werb, and Michael Colliery, was directed by Simon West and based on the video game series Tomb Raider by Core Design. So Tomb Raider and its sequel Tomb Raider 2 sold more than 6 million copies by 1997. Lara Croft was becoming an international sensation, and Eidos started talking to several studios in 1998, but was reportedly unsure whether it wanted a live-action version of the character. It was Paramount's president, John Goldwyn, who made the deal for the studio, and producers Lawrence Gordon and Lloyd Nevin that persuaded Eidos to Tomb Raider's suitability for a live-action film adaptation and its strong character and story. The deal with Paramount, which eyed the project as a possible franchise vehicle, had several ancillary and merchandising components, including the intended simultaneous release of a counterpart game with the film. Most importantly, it included a clause in the contract that if no work was done on the movie for more than 45 days, the option to make the film would be lost, and the rights would revert back to Eidos, which made Paramount step up and start commissioning writers for scripts, including from Brett Friedman, who wrote Mortal Kombat Annihilation, and Steven E. D'Souza, who wrote and directed Street Fighter. Incredible video game movie pedigree, you'll agree. And no, I'm not joking. Check out the previous episodes of the podcast on both of those movies for more information on why they're actually pretty decent movies with fascinating histories. Yes, even Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Both scripts by Friedman and D'Souza would be rejected by Paramount, though, and by 1999, no less than 11 writers had had a go at writing a Tomb Raider movie. Before it even had a script, though, it had a director. Con Air and Rick Astley's Never Gonna Give You Up, nope, not Rick Rolling You, director Simon West, was working with Paramount on the thriller The General's Daughter, and it was an agreeable partnership, so when Paramount mentioned they had a big-budget tentpole action-adventure movie, West signed up for Tomb Raider, and the first thing he did was discard all the previously written draft script and hired his own writers to do more drafts, which he would then also discard and insist on rewriting the Massett and Zinman script himself, hence the adaptation by credit, and the risk of the studio losing the rights to this incredibly lucrative property meant that they needed to keep moving on the script at all times. Some of the early scripts for the movie focused more on Lara's sex appeal. These included scenes like when she uses her breasts to crush a giant millipede in the Mike Werb and Michael Colliery November 1999 script, and when she showed off her breasts to some villains as a diversion in Steven E. D'Souza's February 1999 script. And many more scenes along these lines, supposedly including her showering, bathing, skinny dipping, and losing her bikini while fighting a creature. But these were changed and toned down with each new script, possibly due to ratings issues. Tomb Raider had a $115 million budget, and to finance the movie, Sherry Lansing and Paramount took advantage of a German tax shelter, where investors could take advantage of instant tax deductions, even on non-German productions, by selling the copyright of the movie to a German company for $94 million and then buying it back for $83.6 million, essentially making $10.2 million, and then reselling the copyright to a British investment group and buying it back for a $12 million profit. It then took advantage of the UK film industry, which as long as you film in Britain and have British actors in your movie, you can also receive tax relief. If before filming had started, Paramount had sold the rights to the film to distributors in Japan, Britain, France, Germany, Italy and Spain for $65 million. Despite this outward confidence, the studio was incredibly nervous about having a female-fronted action-adventure movie. This was a lucrative project and it needed to get going with filming ASAP, but it couldn't do that without Lara herself. And while Angelina Jolie is pretty perfect in retrospect, her casting came with a level of controversy based on her private life at the time, her well-publicised marriage to Billy Bob Thornton, and the things they liked to get up to behind closed doors. Director Simon West, though, saw Jolie as the sort of tough, no-nonsense woman who was perfect to play Lara Croft. This was despite some of the biggest actresses of the late 90s and early 2000s vying for the role. Actors like Jennifer Love Hewitt, Famke Janssen, Jennifer Lopez, Elizabeth Hurley, Ashley Judd, Sandra Bullock, Catherine Zeta-Jones, Diane Lane, Demi Moore, and thanks to Wild Things, the fans' number one choice was a certain Denise Richards. Richards would channel Lara somewhat in her outing as Dr. Christmas Jones in The World Is Not Enough with the tank top shorts combo. And the tank top and shorts combo that Jolie wore, she only wore it because she knew the fans would want it. She wasn't keen because, quite rightly, it's not really ideal tomb raiding attire. Costumes were created by Lindy Hemming, the same Lindy Hemming who'd go on to do costumes for Wonder Woman. That's episode 246 of this podcast. And when I say the male gaze is all over this movie. It focuses a lot on Lara's breasts, her bum, her body. If they can get a shot of Angelina Jolie's boobs, then they absolutely will in this movie. Now, it's worth saying that at the time, Angelina Jolie was a recent Oscar winner for Girl Interrupted in 1999, and her star was rising. Lara Croft Tomb Raider may not be charged with changing cinema, but it would thrust Jolie into the mainstream, and her chance to take the role of Lara would change her life, quite literally. She fell in love with Cambodia during filming in the country. Her love for Cambodia would lead to her humanitarian work there. Eventually, she would own a home in the country. But the most important result of her love for the country would be that it would lead to her first love, so to speak, because it led to her adopting her first child, Maddox, a Cambodian orphan. It would also lead to the downfall of her relationship with her real-life father, John Voight, playing her fictional father, Richard Croft, as well as the downfall of her marriage to Billy Bob Thornton. But nevertheless, this would be a life-changing movie for Angelina Jolie, as she trained intensively for 3 months prior to the start of shooting. Stunt coordinator Simon Crane and his team devised a training program that concentrated on multiple disciplines: Voight training, weapons training, motorbike riding, gymnastics, canoeing, husky dog racing, bungee training, and for relaxation, yoga. The bungee ballet sequence was completely Angelina Jolie, with no stunt double used. Jolie did attempt most of the stunts herself as well. Filming would take place from July to November 2000 on location in Cambodia, which was allowed as long as the characters didn't use guns. And this was the first time a big Hollywood film was given permission to film in Cambodia since 1964. Filming also took place at Hatfield House in Hertfordshire as Lara's country manor, and on the 007 stage at Pinewood Studios. At one end of the stage stood the Tomb of the Dancing Light, and at the other, the Temple at 10,000 Shadows, the former linking to exterior scenes filmed in Cambodia and the latter to scenes set in Siberia, although these scenes were actually filmed in Iceland. The Tomb of the Dancing Light was a massive four-story construction dominated at one end by a huge six-armed Buddha. Around the tomb are stone monkey warriors protecting it from harm. The Temple of the 10,000 Shadows was dominated by a gigantic orrery, defined in the dictionary as an apparatus for representing the positions, motions and phases of the planets and satellites in the solar system, named after Charles Boyle, Earl of Orrery, for whom it was first made. In addition to the two sets on the 007 stage, there was also the interior of Croft Manor, with his own internal tomb training room and robot adversary, Simon. Simon West clearly loved naming things after himself in this movie. Paramount and West, though, started to experience some creative differences on the movie. Paramount felt West had blown the budget. He delivered his first cut of the movie, which was over 2 hours long, and Paramount executives hated it. They thought it was terrible, and so they called on famous fixer and renowned editor Stuart Baird to re-edit the movie to make it better. West would return for some necessary reshoots, but was otherwise removed from the production. For Baird's trouble, he'd be given the directorial gig on Star Trek Nemesis and an executive producer credit for Lara Croft Tomb Raider for getting the movie down to a compact 100-minute runtime, removing many of the scenes of Lara being shown in a more sexual nature, including a second shower in a waterfall, clearly Lara Croft loves to shower, and a completely nude scene in order to retain a PG-13 rating. Most of these cutscenes would never be included in future DVD releases, but would be included in the trailer. After West was effectively fired from the movie, his chosen composer, Greg Hale-Jones, along with Danny Elfman's original theme, were both scrapped. Michael Kamen was hired and composed a score, which was rejected once Baird's editing started. Graham Revel was then hired and had to compose a score in just 10 days. And the soundtrack includes Basement Jaxx's Where's Your Head At, which is about as 2001 as you can 2001. Seriously though, Basement Jaxx are great. They had some bangers in the early 2000s. Despite all these issues, when Lara Croft Tomb Raider was released on the 15th of June 2001, it hit number one at the US box office and a $64 million first week, dropping to number three in its second week after the releases of The Fast and the Furious and Dr. Dolittle 2. On its $115 million budget, it made $131.2 million domestically in the US, then the top haul for a female-fronted action film in history, and $143.5 million internationally, for a total worldwide gross of $274.7 million. Because of the generous and lucrative sales of the rights, as well as DVD rentals of $38.5 million, it was considered a success. Not really critically, though. Reviews were generally negative but praised Jolie's casting, but the plot and action sequences were criticised. Me personally, I just think this movie is dumb fun, but Lara feels really underdeveloped and deserves much more of a motivation than just avenging her possibly dead father and then her almost dead sort of lover. Bechdel test passing, this movie is not. Lara could have been a great character had Jolie been given more to do than just offer the odd quip and a bit of breast padding. But the financial success of this movie on its own warranted a sequel, which unsurprisingly had issues of its own. So here's the trailer for Lara Croft Tomb Raider, The Cradle of Life.
In 2300 BC, an Egyptian pharaoh found a place that he named the Cradle of Life. And there he found a box which contained life and death. And it has never been seen since.
His name is Jonathan Rice. He doesn't care who his weapons kill or why.
Rice is going to find Pandora's box.
You mean the Greek myth?
That's the Sunday school version. It's a weapon more powerful than you could ever imagine.
We'll assign two of our best agents.
I don't want them. I need an insider, someone who knows their methods, their hideouts. I need Terry Sheridan.
Croft.
No guns, no weapons of any kind.
Talk about taking the fun out of life. Mm.
So this rock is the map to Pandora's box.
Lara!
It's in Africa.
Africa it is.
Men are coming for the box.
No one who has gone looking for this has come back.
Thank you. Take us to the cradle of life. It's your destiny to see what's inside.
Intrepid British archaeologist Lara Croft has made perhaps the most important archaeological discovery in history, an orb that leads to the mythical Pandora's box. The orb falls into the hands of Jonathan Royce, an evil scientist who deals in killer viruses and hopes to sell the secrets of the box as the ultimate weapon. Recruited by British intelligence to get the orb back from Royce, Lara recruits Terry Sheridan, a British Marine turned mercenary, and her former lover to help. The two embark on an adventure that spans continents in an attempt to regain the orb. Let's run through the cast of this one. We have Angelina Jolie as Lara Croft, Kieran Hines as Dr. Jonathan Royce, Gerard Butler as Terry Sheridan, Chris Barry as Hillary, Noah Taylor as Bryce, Jaiman Usu as Kosa, Till Schweiger as Sean, and Simon Yam as Chen Lo. Lara Croft Tomb Raider, The Cradle of Life has a screenplay by Dean Georgiaris, story by Stephen E. D'Souza and James V. Hart, was directed by Jan de Bont, and based on the video game series Tomb Raider by Core Design. So while Tomb Raider made enough money to greenlight a sequel, Angelina Jolie was harder to convince to return. She would make it clear that her involvement would hinge on a much better screenplay, and in turn for Lara to be a more well-rounded and interesting character with a more diverse wardrobe, thanks yet again to Lindy Hemming, including a silver wetsuit and regionally appropriate items like a silk bomber jacket in China and a tan safari outfit in Africa. Jolie would state in an interview that she hated the character of Lara in the first movie, describing her as a cute girl in tiny shorts. But while rumours swirled that Jolie wouldn't return to the franchise, she did, as she signed a $10 million contract with Paramount Pictures in July 2001, just after the release of the first movie, to return for the sequel, which included a clause to not get pregnant before shooting. Although with her marriage to Billy Bob Thornton on the rocks, that was looking unlikely. So Jolie returned, and so did another name from the previous movie. Stephen E. D'Souza, whose Tomb Raider script had been rejected, would return to write the story of The Cradle of Life along with James V. Hart, with again Lawrence Gordon and Lloyd Levin producing, and they wanted to make this even bigger and better. They ensured they sold the rights beforehand to various companies again, but this time the budget would be smaller, only $95 million, but they were eyeing up a bigger director. Jan de Bont had originally wanted to direct the first movie, however he couldn't due to scheduling conflicts. But he was fascinated with the concept of a smart, sexy heroine, and when he heard Paramount were planning a sequel to Lara Croft Tomb Raider, he contacted them, told them he wanted to do it, and they were delighted to have him aboard. Obviously, he'd been a successful cinematographer for many years before directing Speed, obligatory Keanu reference, and Twister, and he had firm ideas of what he wanted out of this movie. A relatable Lara, a contemporary Lara, and a Lara you could take seriously. He worked on the script closely with Dean Georgiaris. There wasn't a rotating door of writers this time around, just Georgiaris from day one until the final day. They had one writer and a director who was known for his action-adventure movies. De Bont worked closely on storyboarding, and he would storyboard almost every scene because every scene would include a big action set piece or visual effects. He'd then essentially disregard the storyboards and just use them as inspiration rather than hard and fast rules for shooting. Filming for The Cradle of Life took place between August 2002 to March 2003, including on location in Hong Kong, Santorini, Tanzania, Kenya, North Wales, doubling for China, and then back to the 007 stages at Pinewood Studios. Just like the first movie, and just like Bond movies, De Bond treated this like an adventure in big exotic locations, bringing the crews to each country and experiencing the logistical difficulties of filming in African countries with little infrastructure and no roads. Thankfully, they had a great product placement deal with Jeep for its new Wrangler Rubicon, especially customised for Lara Croft, to tackle the harsh realities of your cradle of life. That's usually how car ads go, right? But while working on the movie, De Bont praised the crew and tradespeople, as well as the lack of any explosions. He found that very original for a movie of this sort, and he mentions all of this in an interview with The Hollywood Reporter in July 2003. Later, though, His view of the movie soured somewhat. He explained of Paramount's interference and Eidos' interference, and that when he signed on, he wasn't made aware that Eidos had creative control. He would be contacted while filming and told of changes that had to be done immediately. On the first day of shooting in Greece, he was told he needed to cut $12 million from the budget straight away, regardless of how that might affect the story. He even anecdotally mentioned in a 2020 interview with Uproxx that an unnamed executive didn't like the style of buttons on a male actor's shirt. He would, however, praise Angelina Jolie's commitment to the character, despite feeling that she was slightly difficult to work with, but not in a negative way, just opinionated, which I realise makes no sense, but he genuinely said this. He also did say that he liked the actress very much. This time there were no issues with first cuts or composers. Alan Silvestri composed the score, and with the lack of any issues and lack of rotating writers, a lead actress happier with the direction her character was going in, and a director who didn't get booted off the project in post-production, things were looking ever so slightly up. Lara Croft 2 Raider the Cradle of Life, which is an endlessly ridiculous long title, was released in the US on the 25th of July 2003, and had to settle with the debut at 5th place, behind Spy Kids 3 Game Over, also out the same week, Pirates of the Caribbean, The Curse of the Black Pearl, Bad Boys 2 and Seabiscuit, also new that week. Lara seemingly struggled against the big budget competition and her gross proved it. On a $95 million budget, The Cradle of Life grossed $65.7 million domestically in the US and $94.4 million internationally for a total worldwide gross of $160.1 million. It was considered to be a domestic box office failure despite critics warming to the sequel. The experience and the commercial disappointment would leave Jan de Bont feeling disillusioned, and he ended up retiring from directing after the experience of making this movie. And just before The Cradle of Life debuted in US cinemas on the 25th of July 2003, Tomb Raider The Angel of Darkness was released for the PlayStation 2 in June in North America and early July in the UK and Europe. Paramount would blame the lackluster response to The Cradle of Life to The Angel of Darkness's poor performance. Shares of video game maker Eidos Interactive fell in June 2003 after the company announced that it wouldn't make profit forecasts for the year due to the delays in delivering Tomb Raider The Angel of Darkness. The stock fell nearly 6% after it said it wouldn't be able to ship the game by the 30th of June, the final day of its financial year. They met the deadline in the US but not in Europe, which affected its pre-tax profits. Executive producer of both movies and senior Eidos executive Jeremy Heath-Smith resigned days after the game was released. A third movie was still on the cards despite the lackluster box office of The Cradle of Life. However, Jeremy quashed the idea by saying she felt like they didn't need to do another. She was happy with The Cradle of Life and it was the one they really wanted to do. As for Lara's ongoing video game adventures, writer Rihanna Pratchett delivered Lara's reboot in 2013 with a goal to reintroduce her as an idol for the young women who'd always been playing video games but never really had many avatars for their own experiences. Pratchett focused on Lara's vulnerability and fears, as well as her bravery and confidence, reinventing Lara for a new generation as a young postgrad on her first adventure. This led to her being reinvented for a new generation of cinema goers, with 2018's Tomb Raider starring Alicia Vikander, which I may come back to in a future episode, but it would go on to make about the same at the box office as the 2001 movie, so it was unfortunately considered a box office disappointment. However, it would be an attempt to take on the rebooted Lara Croft, and the critics would favour it ever so slightly more than the previous two movies. I actually have a real fondness for these Angelina Jolie Lara Croft movies. The first more than the second, actually. But then I enjoy them more for their ridiculousness than for their exceptional storytelling and well-rounded female character. They are dumb. They are fun movies, and that is it, no more, no less. The clear distinction between the first and second is pretty obvious. The first is a bit of an incoherent mess featuring the Illuminati, extended shower scenes, and a MacGuffin that Lara could have destroyed straight away, saving a hot guy and her daddy issues. And the second is also an incoherent mess featuring Pandora's box, no shower scenes at all, and the MacGuffin that Lara couldn't destroy straight away, killing a hot guy and then not opening Pandora's box. But it still invokes the spirit of playing Tomb Raider. I played the first one a bit, the second one religiously, and the third one often. Having a female character in a video game felt revolutionary at the time, and as a female gamer, I always tended to pick female characters in fighting games, so having Lara as the only choice felt original. It didn't matter to me that she was the epitome of what a young lad wanted to see in a video game. She was what I wanted to see in a video game. Angelina Jolie was pretty perfect casting, and I wish they'd given her more to do. In both movies, although the latter does treat her with a bit more respect, there's definitely something great underneath all of this. Like, you feel like there are some good movies in there. They're just really struggling to get out. And a lot of male writers had a lot of input in these movies, but then a lot of male developers had a lot of input in the character initially too. Tomb Raider was a video game ripe for a film adaptation. And while Alicia Vikander's version is a hell of a lot better, these ones feel like video games. They're a bit cheesy, they're fun with a drink or two, and they operate on their own internal logic. It's shut off your brain and enjoy type of entertainment. And it focuses on boobs, brawn and brains, in that order. These movies are a bit like when you meet the final boss in a video game and you just bash all of the controller buttons in no logical order to get the win. That is these movies. And the fact they made it to the screen at all is exactly why this podcast exists in the first place. So just put on your dance mix CD, listen to some Basement Jacks and shoot things because it's fun. Let's just hope it doesn't take Hollywood another 5,000 years to figure out how to make another good Tomb Raider movie. Thank you for listening. As always, I would love to hear your thoughts on Lara Croft Tomb Raider and Lara Croft Tomb Raider, The Cradle of Life. And thank you, as always, for your continued support of this podcast. If you have enjoyed this episode, even though it's a bit different to the norm, and you would like to help spread the word of Verbal Diorama, you can. You could tell your friends and family about this podcast. You could leave a rating or review wherever you found this podcast. And you can also find me and follow me on social media. I am at Verbal Diorama on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Threads, Blue Sky and Letterboxd. If you like this episode on Lara Croft Tomb Raider and Lara Croft Tomb Raider Cradle of Life, you might also like some other episodes I've done on some other video game movies. Episode 159, Mortal Kombat and Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Another double episode, another pair of movies that the critics hated, but that I have a lot of time for because they're dumb fun. And sometimes you just need a bit of dumb fun in your life. And the stories behind those movies are incredible, actually. And episode 233, Street Fighter, for the same reason, because it's just a dumb fun movie, but it has a really fascinating history, a really fascinating story behind it. And it's a story that I don't think many people know about, apart from the fact that Jean-Claude Van Damme enjoyed copious amounts of drugs while shooting. Everyone knows that story, but there are other stories behind the making of Street Fighter that you probably didn't know, that you might want to know about that movie. So if you've not seen those movies in a while, please watch them, and then please listen to those episodes. Great Scott! It's the next episode, the 250th episode of this podcast. Where we're going, we don't need roads. And if my calculations are correct, when this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're going to get the 250th episode of Verbal Diorama in your ears. Back in the days when Ronald Reagan, the actor, was president, and you needed a nuclear reaction to generate 1.21 gigawatts of electricity to power a DeLorean, a young man called Calvin Klein changed the course of his own personal history by accidentally dating his own mother. I guess you guys aren't ready for that yet, but your kids are going to love it. It's your density to listen. The next episode is on the history and legacy of Back to the Future. So make look a tree and get out of here till next week. And join me for the history and legacy of Back to the Future. And as I always say, just by listening to this podcast, you are supporting this podcast, and I'm so grateful. But if you wish to support this podcast financially and you have the means to do so, then that would be amazing. And you can do it in one of two ways. You could go to verbaldiorama.com/tips and give a one-off tip, or you could go to verbaldiorama.com/Patreon and you could join the amazing patrons of this podcast. They are Simon E, Sade, Claudia, Simon B, Laurel, Derek, Kat, Andy, Mike, Luke, Michael, Scott, Brendan, Lisa, Sam, Jack, Dave, Stuart, Nicholas, Soe, Kev, Pete, Heather, Danny, Ali, Stu, Brett, Philip, Michelle, Zenos, and Sean. If you want to get in touch and you want to say hi, you can email me, verbaldiorama@gmail.com. Or if you go to my website, verbaldiorama.com, and you can fill out the little contact form there and you can say hi, you can give me feedback and you can offer suggestions as well. And you can also find my work at filmstories.co.uk. There's a new issue of the magazine coming soon. Please go to the website, please purchase it, and please check it out. It is my 40th column for Film Stories magazine. And finally...
So it's come to this, has it? Well, you do have authorization to kill me. Better do it then. Because if you think standing in front of me is going to be enough... You don't have it in you to stop me. See, all your beliefs, all your ideals, they're not real. I am. And you've loved me. I don't know how strong you think you are, but you are not going to choose them over me. Now move. Fine.
Bye. Movie should know.